Good afternoon. Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Great. So, everything okay? Any questions? Okay, yeah. So I think at this moment, let's look at what we have done. So can you guys see my screen? Okay, thank you. Okay, so you can see that we have around 4 to 5 labs. We finished 3. Okay. So then for memory part, actually, we don't have any more lab exercise. After we enter into what's going on here? Yeah. Okay, so what I'm seeing is that labs, we already finished 3 lab exercise. After we get into the concurrency, probably next week, we have a 2 more exercise. So in total, we have 5 lab exercise. So for assignment, actually the first one has been finished. Second one, you guys already submit. The tutor will finish the grading and release the marking scheme and your grade. Maybe today or tomorrow, okay? So before this weekend, okay? So basically paper-based assignment, okay? Then assignment 3 and project. So basically already released, right? So you guys can do assignment 3 and project, and also this one, bonus assignment 1, right? So this 3 assignment are ongoing, okay? So particularly for those paper-based assignment, which are very easy, then you have to finish. You have to, okay? In order to pass this course, right? Okay, yeah. So tutor will release the grade of assignment 2 very soon. So if you have any issues related to the grading and so on, so please contact the tutor, okay? Don't wait, okay? Sometimes the student wait until the last minutes after the final exam, then after I submit the grade, then you guys send me email, say, okay, can I change? I find the mistake and so on. So, but it's a little bit too late. So we already sent the grade to the department. So it's very hard to change at that moment. Okay, anyway, so let me go back to the lectures. Okay, so last time actually we talked about segmentation and paging. Okay, so the idea kind of simple. Okay, so when we talk about segmentation, basically it's based on the base and bound So before we will set up the virtual, we will allocate memory, physical memory based on virtual space, virtual address space, then use base and bound. But now use segmentation, we will use based on the different component inside a virtual space. For example, based on code, heap, stack, right? So basically that's segmentation. Then we talk about how to do it and so on. Then because segmentation may cause external fragmentation, also it's a little bit hard to manage the space. So people later invent paging. Okay, so paging is based on a very simple idea. Then we, generally speaking, we divide our virtual space, okay, our address space, into fixed size page. Okay. Then of course, physical memory also is divided into the same size of a page. Okay, we call page frame. Then for each process, per process, you can look at here. This is the keywords. You need to notice for each process, we have one page table. Then this is used to map the virtual address of a process of address space into the physical address. So basically we do allocation based on the page, right? So we also talk about some example and so on, right? Then in this way, actually the implementation is very simple. We talk about this, right? So generally speaking, we only need to maintain, kind of a free list for the pages, free pages, right? Then we do the allocation. Then if we free the space, we just put those physical page frame into the list. That's it, okay? Then of course it may introduce internal fragmentation, which means we allocate one page to a process, but it may not be fully utilized. However, because the page size usually is not large, so it's okay with a little bit. So that's a general idea. By the way, today I'm at home because we have a COVID positive case occurred in engineering building at a ninth floor. So I have to stay here, stay at home. But anyway, so what I'm seeing is that I may have some internet issue. If there's any abnormal situations, please immediately let me know. So yeah, so I can somehow, right, do some makeup and so on. Yeah. Okay, so then we also talk about now it's very simple. Basically, we provide an example. I think last time we talked about this. Generally speaking, suppose we have this is our physical address space. Suppose we have 64 bytes. Then suppose we have a process virtual address space, which is 64 bytes address space. Our physical memory is 128 bytes, okay, in total. Then suppose a page size is 16 bytes, okay? So you can see here, for our physical space, we divide this into 16 bytes fixed unit. We call page frame. You can see like page frame 0, first 16, right? Page frame 1, and so on, right? So this is our physical space. Then for our virtual space, we also divide our virtual space into 16 bytes sized page. Okay, you can see this is our virtual page. You can see it's first page, second page, and so on. Then we can have a mapping table here, basically from 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so this is our virtual page number. Then we find corresponding physical page. For example, here, our virtual page 0 is stored in here, right? In physical page frame 3, so we put 3 here. Then our virtual page 1 is stored in page frame 7, so we put 7 here. So our virtual page 2 is put into physical page frame 5, so we put here, set up this mapping, right? Our virtual page 3 is allocated to page frame 2. So we put this 2 here into our page table. So this is our page table. Then later, whenever we have a virtual address memory access, we will go to this page table to do the mapping. Okay, in this way, we can find the physical location. Okay, I notice there are some questions. So let me go back to look at the question. Yeah. So what is the page table? Where is the page table stored? Okay, so from the chat box, there is one question is asking where to store page table. This is a very good question. Okay, so generally speaking, this page table will be stored into the memory. Okay, we have nowhere to store page table. Everything must be stored into the memory, right? So how to store? We will talk about that. That's a very important topic, okay, for page table. Okay, so then address translation, use this example, right? Address translation, usually we have to look at a virtual address. What is the page size? For example, here, this is our virtual address. 16 bytes, right? Then we will look at the page size. Our page size is 16 bytes. So 16 bytes, we have 2^4 equal to 16, right? So basically this is our offset. We have 4 bits. Then other part is for virtual page number. So given a virtual address now, we will first use our virtual page number to do the address translation based on our page table. For example, 0, 1, then we go to the page mapping table, the second entry, then find the physical frame. For example, physical frame is this one, 111. Okay, then we put we get this physical page frame number, then put the original offset, then we have the physical address. Then we can continue for the memory access. Okay, I hope this is clear. Then go back to the page table. Okay, I think this is related to one student question. So where the page table is stored, right? So, answer, memory, okay? Of course, we have to store our page table into the memory page, okay? However, you can see that page table can be very large, okay? For example, in our Intel architecture, our address space is 32 bits, okay? So suppose we use 32 bits as our address space. Okay, so we gave the full 32 bits for a particular, for any process, it can have 32-bit virtual address. Okay. Certainly you have a bigger virtual address space is good, right? So we don't put any limitation. So then basically we can have a, we can have bigger code size, bigger heap, bigger stack and so on, right? So this is good. Then suppose our page size is 4 kilobytes. Okay, let's think about our address now. Our virtual address in total is from bit 0 to bit 31. Okay, this is a bit 30. Okay, this is a bit 0, bit 1, and so on, right? Okay, so totally is 32 bits. Okay, then our page size is 4 kilobytes. Okay, 4 kilo actually equal to 2 power 12, right? 4 kilo. K is 2 power 10. So 4 kilo is 2 power 12. So we have, suppose this is bit 11. Okay, so we have 11 from zero to bit 0 to bit 11. We have 12 bits. This is for our offset. This is offset. Okay. This part, in total, we have 32 bits, right? So if we have 12 bits for offset, then we have 20 bits for virtual page number. Okay, we have a huge, okay, address space. Then, suppose, okay, each page table entry, we need 4 bytes. Okay, then how many entries we have here? We have, because see, this is our virtual page part, right? In total, we have 20 bits. Okay, so in total, we have 2 power 20 entries for our page mapping table, right? So you think about here, right? So basically, because we have 20 bits for our virtual address, our virtual page number, so we have 2 power 20 entries. Okay, then suppose each entry, which is the mapping, right? From virtual page number to physical page number, we need 4 bytes. Suppose, later we'll talk about this detail, but at this moment, suppose we need 4 bytes for each page table entry. Then in total, we have 4 megabytes here for each process. You may say, it's not a big deal, right? But think about that. Suppose inside our system, suppose we have 1,000 process running, okay? Then each one, we need 4 megabytes. Then in total, we may need 4 gigabytes physical memory, okay? So this is not our process address space. This is only for mapping table, right? So before we run any process, we already occupy 4 gigabytes physical space. So basically, if we utilize this way to store our page table, actually, we may occupy huge memory space for this page table, right? So we'll talk about later, okay? Then how to handle this, okay? Generally speaking, we will play the trade-off between performance and the space. Last time we also talked about this, right? So when we talk about the space and the trade-off in what? We also talk about a space and a performance trade-off. So we want to utilize the small space to remember the mapping table. Still also is a mapping table, right? Do you still remember that? Hello, guys. We spent a lot of time on that issue, right? Inside iNode, I remember. When we map the file linear space to the data block, right? Yeah. Several students answer me, right? So basically, when we talk about the file address space inside iNode, we have some direct pointer, then we have indirect pointer. Remember? Actually, that one also we use indirection. We add the indirection. Then you through the indirection, actually, we can represent a huge space. At the same time, we only need inside iNode, we only need a fixed number, very small. In total, we have very few bytes we use. Then we can represent a huge address space, right? So similarly, we use a similar idea. So we end the indirection. Later, I will talk about this, okay? How to handle this big page table. So let's continue, okay? So basically what is a page table? Page table is a data structure that is used to map the virtual address to physical address. Simply we can use a linear array to represent this, okay? Then for index, actually use a virtual page number, then we don't need to store this one. We only need to store our corresponding physical page frame, which is allocated for this particular virtual page number, okay? So let's look at what kind of information usually we need for this page table entry, okay? So usually we need a validation bit indicate whether or not this translation is valid. So that means given this virtual address, this virtual page, whether or not this virtual address has been allocated into our process for use, okay? So protection bit indicate the permission for read, write, execution, okay? Present bit, okay? So later we'll talk about this, but generally speaking, we want to extend our physical memory with a hard disk. So this bit is used to represent whether or not this particular virtual page is mapped into physical memory or mapped into the disk. We call swap error, okay? 30 bit indicate whether or not this page has been modified. Okay, so basically after we load data from the disk, maybe we already change the bit. Then later when we evict this page from the memory, then maybe for those 30 page, we have to write back. Reference bit indicate if this page has been accessed and so on. So generally speaking, that's what we need, okay? So give you a real example here from x86 page table entry, you can see that we may have a P, this bit, read, write, P is present, right? So we talk about this one. Basically, either this is in memory or in swap area. So we also have some user space or supervisor space. Basically, this is our privilege, right? Root privilege and general user mode, yeah. Then access bit, A is access bit, dirty bit. Then most important thing is the corresponding page frame number we used for this virtual page, okay. So then to find the location for desired page table entry, so which means which page frame is allocated to a particular virtual page, then we have to have a register to remember our page table, starting location, right? A page table. We need this one. Okay. Usually we have a we call page table base register, right? Page table base register, kind of, right? So use this one, we can find our page table, then from page table, then we can find the corresponding mapping. Okay. Then paging actually introduced the overhead. Before, when we don't have any paging, we can directly find our physical memory. Now, because page table is stored inside the memory, then for every memory reference, now we have to first go to page table to find the translation, then use the translation when we find the corresponding physical memory address, then we can do memory access. Because this is a kind of a slow, usually this is a translation is handled by a hardware. So we have a technique called MMU to help us to handle this. Okay, so here to describe the process. So as I mentioned, this part usually is implemented by hardware. We have a hardware unit called memory managed unit, help us to do this address translation automatically. Of course, we can also use software to do it, right? But the algorithm you can see here is very simple. First, for every memory access, if we are using paging, then first from the virtual address, we get the virtual page number. Okay, so remember, we need to do some shifting. We need to get the corresponding virtual page number, that part. For example, in IA32, we only want to get the most significant 20 bits, right? Then shift, then get the virtual page number, then use PDPR, PTBR, right? As I mentioned, right? This is our page table base register to remember the base, the starting location of our page table. Then through this PTPR plus our virtual page number and the size of a PTE, then we can find the corresponding entry for our page table entry inside the memory. Okay, this is the first thing we have to get the address, right? Then first memory is go to our page table based on this page table entry address to get our PTE, page table entry. Then follow the PTE. First, is this valid? Which means, okay, is this a translation valid or not, right? So if it's not valid, so we have segmentation fault, okay? So this is a kind of a exception from the hardware. So we generated this exception. The operating system usually have some software to handle this exception. So basically we go to the operating system will tell you segment fault, okay? Then second part, if this is okay, this translation is valid, then we go to see whether or not this protection bit is allowed. Of course, it depends on our read-write or execution, right? Based on this one, if we don't allow this to be accessed, then we generate another exception called protection, general protection fault. Okay, this is also another exception than operating system handle to show you the error. After that, which means, oh, this PTE entry is okay. Then we go to, now we really get the address, right? So you can see that first get offset, then use PTE entry, get our physical address, physical page number, right? Then put this physical page plus the offset together, get the physical address, then we can do the memory access. Okay, so generally speaking, that's the whole process. So with this, actually, I finished the introduction about the basic memory management method. Okay, so to summarize, we talk about segmentation. So segmentation is based on the base and bound. Basically, it's compared to base and bound, now we divide our virtual address into a small component called the stack and heap. Then for each one, we have base and bound. For paging, actually, it's totally different approach from segmentation. So our physical memory is split into the fixed size page frame. Our virtual address space also is split into fixed size the page. Okay, then we use a page table for each process to do the translation between virtual address to physical address. Okay, so so that's all for this part. Okay, so let me look at some questions. Okay, I noticed we have some questions. Yeah, so you guys can continue. You guys can continue to post the question. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, everything okay, right? At this moment. Network is okay, huh? Hello, guys. Okay, great. Okay. Yeah, so first question. It's still segment, but divided into page. Basically segmentation and the paging are two different approach. Right, think about that. Segmentation is more related to the base and bound, but paging is basically we divide our address into the fixed size page. Then we generate a page table to do the mapping, right? But segmentation is that we have base and bound, either it's based on the whole virtual address, virtual space, or we based on a small segment, a small component, right? Code, a stack, and a heap. Then for each one, we have a base and a bound. Then the mapping table is we also have a segmentation table over there. For each process, actually, it's very small. So this is a totally different approach. So where is the page table store? Yeah, I think I already answered the question, right? So basically in memory. So yeah, I think, so generally speaking, the question is related to, okay, if it's in memory, then if it's too big, then how to handle it, right? How to handle big page table, right? In memory, something like that, right? So we'll talk about that later, right? So this is maybe related to that question. So use the space and the performance trade-off. What about page frame physical mapping? Again, what is the page frame, right? So generally speaking, the question is related to what is the PFN, right? Page frame number. Oh, right. Basically PFN means page frame number. So when we talk about paging, generally speaking, we have, think about that, okay? From our process perspective, we have virtual address space. Oh, we call it address space, right? For our virtual address space, we call it virtual page number. Is this okay? Another one is our physical address space. So which means you buy a DRAM chip, right? So you have a 4 gigabytes, 16 gigabytes and so on. That's our physical memory address. Physical memory address space. So for that one, we have a different name called page frame number. Okay, we use page frame number to represent the page, the number. No matter which is for the virtual address or physical memory address, we will use the same size of page. Then, for the virtual page, we will use VPN to represent virtual page number to represent the page. For the physical memory address, we use PFN, physical frame number, to represent that address, that particular page. I hope I answer your question. Is this okay? Okay, so yeah. Okay, so one more question. Yeah, I hope I answered. I think this is a very important question before we continue. So we have to understand some basic terminology, right? So we have to have very clear definition for the those terms. So virtual page number is used to represent virtual address space. PFN, page physical frame number, is used to represent physical memory address space. Yes, I think I could not copy this question. Okay, so the question is that, do we still have a segmentation? If we use paging, okay. So usually, okay, of course we can have a combination. So later we'll talk about this, but usually we only use one, okay, we only use paging, okay, no combination, okay. Of course, we can combine them together. For example, IA32, it provides segmentation and also paging. So you can put them together to utilize both, but it's too complicated. Usually, when we have paging, we don't use segmentation anymore, okay. Then to answer your question, I think your question is very good. So basically your question is that if we use paging, then how to handle the heap and the stack, right? So we will handle that through the page table, okay? So actually we simplify this design now. Basically everything is goes through the page table. So for the stack, go to the page table. For the heap, go to the page table. Yeah, everything will be handled through the page table. Yeah. So, then the following question is that if we do like this way, then how to separate, right? How to separate. Code, stack, code, heap, stack with paging, right? So because now we don't have a segmentation, we don't have a segment table, right? Then how to identify those different parts? So generally speaking, we don't need to, okay? So we don't need to handle this anymore. From our program, you think about that. Our program code part is our program. So our program will be compiled based on the virtual address. Then this part can handle kind of our code side, right? So memory access, this is correct. Then for the heap part, because when we do, this is why we need to do the malloc. We need the malloc to return a address, return a virtual address. Then utilize that virtual address, right? Actually we can properly access our data we allocate. Or we put into that part of heap, right? So for the stack, generally speaking, after we set up our stack pointer, then we just follow our stack frame, then basically we can handle the stack part. Okay, so every part can be handled properly without segments. Okay, it's only based on paging after the program can run based on this virtual space. Okay, so then from other part, we also have, remember last time we talked about, when we talk about the process, we also have a address space over there. Memory structure, MM structure, right? So we already have the allocation, for example, for the code part, where is our memory address, virtual address, with heap, stack, and so on. So then certainly we also have some bump over there to at the process level to help us to manage those bumps. So I hope I answer your question, yeah. When we do malloc, yes, certainly. When we do malloc, we need to malloc a whole page now. So basically, if we go to the paging, then our basic unit for allocation is one page, right? So because everything is goes through the page table. So either you give me one page or you give me nothing, but that's the basic unit for allocation. Okay, so yeah, I think I still have another question. So how can we know? I think the question is maybe you guys go to the chat box to look at this question. So I hope I can copy this one. So this will be the last question I answer. Then I will go to the slides. Yeah, so. Yeah, I could not copy those question anymore. So can you guys go to the chat box, look at the last question? So I don't need to copy this one. So basically the question is that, how can we know the bound of each page frame? So we don't need to know the bound of page frame, right? Page frame is 4 kilobytes. We already divide the bound. So generally speaking, if we use paging, the virtual address, the physical memory also is divided into the fixed size unit. There's no bound. Every page frame is fixed, 4 kilobytes, for example, 4 kilobytes, okay? Then, okay, so generally speaking, you can think about, okay, so originally, yeah, I think this is a very good question. So you think about that physical memory. Suppose this is our physical memory. Suppose this is from 0 to 4 gigabytes originally, right? So without paging, actually you can give me a memory address, any address, 32-bit address to access the particular byte, right? But with paging, I already divided this into fixed page. So each page, for example, is 4 kilobytes. So this is our page frame 01, page frame frame 0, frame 1, and so on. Each one is a fixed size. So if I give you page frame, for example, page frame 1, actually we already translate this into the physical address. You can see here, right? This is our physical address, right? 4 kilo. Start from 4 kilo, right? The size is 4 kilo, right? So if I give you page PFN 2, so you know this is the fixed size, it's here, the size is clear in memory, right? So we don't need given a page frame number, then we can exactly know the physical location because the size is fixed. This is the beauty why we want to make it become fixed size, right? Yes, okay, usually when we use paging, we have a kind of a mode to switch. Then we have a memory management unit to help us to manage all those memory space. Then everything is goes through this MMU. Then you provide the page table, then we will go through the page table, and from there find the PFN you put into, then find the physical address. Okay, so later we'll talk about this, okay? But this is your homework. So this is a very good question. This is your homework, how to fill up this page table, right? Okay, very good. Looks like we may need a break. Okay, how about we have a 5 minutes break? Okay, then I will go back to continue for our lecture. Then I look at, we already have some questions. So later I will talk about those questions. Okay, so 5 minute break. Let's resume at 3:20. Okay, let's continue. So generally speaking, I finished the first part. Let's go to the, what I want to do is I want to, let me first go through this, some advanced topic. Then if we have time, I will go to show you some example to help you understand better about our paging and so on. So can you guys see my slides, my screen, lecture 11? Hello guys, can you hear me? Can you see the slides? Okay, yeah, great, okay. So yeah, we are still in memory management. Then after this, we'll go to the concurrency. Okay, so we are very close to the end. So the later part of this course. Okay, so first let's look at the performance. So as we mentioned, when we do this paging is slow. The reason is that now we have to go to page table, then get our physical page frame PFN, then use PFN plus the offset, then we can get the physical memory address. Then we go to find our, find the memory address we want to access, right? So, which is slow. This is only one level indirection. If we end up more indirection, more level of indirection as we introduce later, then it's become even slower. Okay, so how to handle this? The idea also is very simple. So call translation look aside buffer. This also is a very common used approach to manage the performance. So if we spend a lot of time to find a particular mapping or some data, should we, if see, later, we may reuse this data. For example, in this case, we try to find a mapping, our page frame number from our page table, we have mapping, right? Later, we may use this again. So we can have a small buffer to remember this mapping between this virtual page number and the corresponding physical page frame, PFN. Page frame from the our mapping table, right? So we can use, this is what we are this here called TLB, translation local set buffer. So actually the small buffer here, we put into our memory management unit. So basically because the translation is slow, so we use the hardware to implement. And also inside hardware, we also, inside this memory management unit, we also put this a small buffer. Then for those popular virtual page number to physical page number mapping, we will put into our TLB. Then basically, you can think about, okay, if we can hit from our MMU, then we don't need to go to our memory to do this translation. We can directly do translation, okay? Then get the physical address, then we can directly get our data. So we only need one, we can directly do memory access. Otherwise, if this is not in TLB, then we have to go to the memory to find our PFN, then put this back into TLB, then we do this translation, okay? So basically that's the idea. So the algorithm you can see is a kind of very simple. You think about that, you have buffer over there, right? So generally speaking, after you get the virtual address, originally you have to go to your, use your page table, BTPR, page table base register, that start location of a page table. You have to go there from the memory to find your corresponding page table entry. Then from there, you find the PFN, page frame number. Then you can continue, right? But right now, if we have a small buffer, then inside our MMU, after we get this virtual page number, then we directly look at whether or not this mapping is stored inside TLB. So if we already find it successfully, okay, so we call TLB hit, then congratulations, okay? We are very lucky. We already have this entry. Then we look at, okay, this corresponding entry, whether or not the protection bit and so on is correct, okay? So if it is correct, then we can use this, get the PFN. This part is our PFN, page frame number. This part is our offset from our virtual address. Then we can directly access physical memory, okay? So this is the path. We have TLB hit, you can see here. So if the mapping already is cached inside this small buffer, then we directly get the entry, get the mapping, then we directly go to the physical memory to get our data, okay? Here, basically, this is related to if the protection is not correct, then we issue the protection error, right? Another part is that if this is not succeed, so basically we have a TLB miss, right? Then in this way, this part is very similar to our, you can see this part is related to our, this is very similar to our ordinary page access. So we use PTPR, go to our page table base address, then get the PTE, that page table entry address, then access it first. Get our PTE entry, blah, 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 right? Then check those permission and so on. So this part is similar. This part is similar basically here. This part is very similar to here. You can see that we will do this and so on, right? To get, check those permission and so on, right? Then suppose this is correct. Then we go back to put, suppose our permission, everything is okay. This PTE entry can be accessed and so on. Then now we will put this into our TRB. We insert this entry into our TRB. When we insert, we have VPN, we have PTE, we have protection bit and so on. Then insert into, then retry this instruction. Okay, so this is the logic is different here. Okay. But before actually, after we get, if we don't have TRB, then we go to, we get the memory address, then we directly do physical access. But here, if we have miss, then we will first go to find our table, then insert this entry into TRB. What I'm saying is that after we get our page table, then insert our TRB, then retry this instruction, okay? Basically. So this is what we're talking about here. So this part of the code is kind of after we check the permission is correct. Now we just insert that entry into our TRB, then retry the instruction. Okay. So why TRB can improve performance? So you can see if we use an array operation here, basically we want to get the summation of 10 array entries. So 10 element, 10 array elements, you can see from A0 to A9. So basically you can see, suppose this nine entries is this nine elements are put into three pages. You can see we have three pages, 0, 6, 7, and 8, right? See, basically, if we use TRB, then we have three misses. So when we access here, in the beginning, we may not have this mapping. Suppose we don't have, then we have miss. Then we will put this entry into our TRB. Then after that, this one will directly go to our TRB for the translation, and also this one. Then when we go here, because this is a new page, suppose we don't have an entry in TRB, then we add this entry into our TRB. Then we have one miss, but for A4, A5, A6, we can directly use that translation. So basically we have hit, right? So then similarly, we have this one. This one is a miss, but we have two more hit. So generally speaking, then we have three misses and seven hits. So hit ratio is 70% or something like that, right? In total it's 10, then we have seven hits. So basically hit rate is 70%, okay? So then let's go to why TRB works. So generally speaking, cache can provide benefit for our program, because we have two locality we call temporal locality. Temporal locality is that you can look at this example. Suppose we first access page one, it's very possible we will re-access page one in the near future, okay? So which means think about that, if we put this mapping into our TRB, then during a short time period, we always have a lot of hits. Then basically we can have benefit based on temporal locality. So here actually is a very good temporal locality. You can see that if we access a page, this virtual page six, then we will frequently access this page again and again, right? So basically this we call temporal locality. Temporal locality is into the time dimension. So we look at the time, then in recent time, then we will access a particular items frequently, okay? Spatial locality is that if a program access memory at a particular address, it will likely access memory those address near X, okay? So then you think about that. So generally speaking, that if we first access page one, then it's very likely in the near future we will access page two, right? So from this example, you can see that when we access page 06, it's very possible we may access 07, right, later, right? So this is called spatial locality. Oh, use another example is that you can see that if we access the address A0, it's very possible we access A1, A2 nearby the allocation, which is inside one page, right? So it's, this is a good example for why we want to use this TLB. We want to have this kind of design to help us to improve the performance, okay? Certainly, TLB can be implemented by either hardware, okay? So, or we can go to software managed TLB. Then if we have a hardware, then of course hardware can be more efficient, right? But hardware, then the design complexity increase. On the other hand, if we make it become a software, then this maybe simplify our hardware, okay? This is a trade-off. Generally speaking, this is a different philosophy when I design the instruction set. So relate to our hardware design. So one is called complex instruction set, okay, computer. For example, a representative is IA32, okay, our Intel processor, which is CISC, okay. Another one is RISC, okay, reduced instruction set. Okay, every instruction is simple. We don't have a complicated hardware. So as long as we can implement your software, then use software, okay. So for this part, representative also is, now is widely used, ARM processor inside your smartphone pad, you already use ARM processor. So here, the main reason is they are not very powerful, but they are very power efficient. Okay, for the mobile device, actually, this is very important. Okay. So basically, yeah, if we want to use hardware, then all logic we mentioned need to be handled by hardware. Otherwise, we have to use we have to have a trap handler use the software to handle this. Okay. Another issue related to how to design TLB. Basically, very simple. TLB is full associative method, fully associative, which means okay, we will use we have to use VPN as the index, then find our corresponding page frame number. Okay, so generally speaking, we need to search the whole TLB. Okay. Then after that, we get our corresponding one. Then of course, we may have some attributes bit, for example, validation bit and so on. Okay, it's very similar to our page table entry, PTN, because basically this is a cache, right, from our PTN entry. Okay, so another issue is related to the context switch. So if we have TLB, then it may happen. We switch from in this case, we have two processes. In the beginning, our page two here, our virtual page, our virtual page 10 is mapped to the physical page frame 100, okay? Inside our TLB. So in TLB, we have to remember virtual page number, as we mentioned, right? So if we don't remember virtual page number, we don't know how to find the corresponding PFN, right? Because we want to find the mapping. So we also have some valid bit and a protection bit as well. So after we do switch, you can see that it may happen After a while, we do the switch to process B. So inside the process B, we also have a same virtual page number, 10, right? You can see the same one, right? Because they are in a different process A and process B, are totally separated. So their virtual page number, certainly they can have the same virtual page number, but they are in different world, right? Then in this case, then you can see we have a same page number, then same VPN, then which one we use, right? So basically that's the issue. When we do the switch, then we may have this issue. So to solve this issue, then we can easily put a address space ID. So generally speaking is that we know, oh, for this VPN actually is from a particular process. For another VPN actually is from another process. That's it. After we end this address space ID, then we can distinguish this mapping is from which process and so on. Another issue is that if you want to share one page, it's okay. So this is a very simple, you can see here. So if from a different process, process one and process two, they want to share the same physical page frame, this is okay. So you think about that in previous case, now we have two process, okay? Two process. Suppose this page and this page, they want to share the same page, physical page. This is okay, we just set up our mapping table correspondingly. Then it's also very useful when we, usually when we want to share some information, transfer information, right? So we can share, we can have a shared memory. Then through this shared page, then we can, I send data to this page, then you read, right? Of course, we need some protocol, but generally speaking, this provides a mechanism for data communication between two processes. So sharing physical page is useful. Basically, we can, of course, this is for the communication. Also, if this is utilized for the code, suppose the two programs use the same code segment, same instruction, right? Same program, then basically we can also share those physical page. So we can reduce the physical page frame to be used, okay? Then another issue when we handle this buffer, right? So whenever we have a small buffer, we call cache. So we have to consider the cache replacement issue. Then the most commonly used approach called LRU, least recent use. So for example, give you an example here. Suppose our page frame here, we only have three page frame. We only have three page frame, okay? Then this is our virtual page access. Okay, this is our virtual page access. Okay, suppose the first time we access virtual page 7, then this will be allocated into the physical page frame 0. You can see here, right? So 7 is here. Then we access virtual page 0. So virtual page 0 is allocated into this page, physical page frame. Suppose this is a 1, okay, 0, 1, 2. Right? This is our physical page frame. Then we go to the virtual page number 1. Okay, then all pages, all physical pages, physical page frame are allocated, right? Then next time we have two, we want to access virtual page 2. We don't have physical page frame now, okay? So we don't have this, so in this case, actually we're talking about mapping, right? So basically TRB, we want to have a small buffer to remember this mapping. So we only have three entries inside here. We only have three entries, right? Then we don't have enough entry to store this mapping. Then we have to kick out one. The least recent use is that we will see that because 7 is the least recent use, because we use 0 right now, we chose 0 at this moment. This is the least recent use. So we will kick out this entry. Okay, then replaced with 2, this mapping and so on. So you can see this is how we utilize this LRU to do this kind of buffer management replacement. So replacement policy. So generally speaking is that evict an entry that has not recently been used. Okay. So basically this takes advantage of locality in the memory reference stream. So may I ask you a question, how to implement this LRU? Because you guys already learned this structure, right? So let me see. Q, yes. Q is okay. Yeah, but it should be a special Q, right? Q usually is the first in, first out, right? So generally speaking, maybe we have a list. How about that? Okay. Then whenever we have, suppose we have a list here. Whenever we have a new entry, we will add this into at the end of the list. Okay. So if we have access for a particular entry, then we will move this to the end of list. Okay. Move the location. Then use this approach. If we want to do the replacement, which one we should pick up from our list, if this is a head here. So basically my approach is that, okay, if I access a particular entry, right? Then I will go to this entry, then move this entry to the end of the list. Okay, then for the newly added entry, because newly added, which means I use this one, right? So I also put it into end of the list, right? Then naturally, okay, the head, this entry at the head of the list becomes the least recent use entry. So I just, if I don't have enough space, I just evict this one. That's it, right? Is this clear? So this is a very simple stuff, right? So I think you guys already learned a lot to advance this structure. Okay, so real TLB entry, you can see here, the difference here is that we need to remember VPN from our page table entry, page table entry. Remember we talk about page table entry. Page table entry actually is inside our page table. This one is inside TLB. This is a kind of a cache of our PT entry. But here we need to remember VPN. We need to remember process ID. Okay, then we need to remember the corresponding PFN, our physical memory address. Then certainly we also have some attributes we need to remember, okay? Okay, so what time is it? Yeah, we still have a lot of time, that's great, okay? Okay, so next, let me finish this advanced paging. So I will go back to answer your question. Okay. I know you may have some questions. I think the first part actually, when we talk about TIB, we talk about the performance, right? Because after we have paging, now we at least we need one more memory access in order to do memory access. The reason is that we have to go to the mapping table. Mapping table is stored into the memory. So we have to go there to find it. So the idea here is that we have a small buffer. Then in the buffer, we store this mapping, right? Then if we have a TLB hit, this small buffer we call TLB. If TLB hit, we already find the mapping, then we don't need to go to the memory. So that's a benefit for the performance. Now, based on the locality, then this can help us to reduce memory access, improve the performance. But we still have another issue. As we mentioned before, we have the size issue. The page table actually is huge, right? So how to handle that? So this advanced paging is related to the size issue, how to reduce the size. The problem is that each process has one page table, okay? Let's assume it's 32-bit address space with 4 kilobyte pages, and our page entry is 4 bytes. Then you can see for our page table here, because we have total address space 2^32, right? Each page is 2^12, 4 kilobytes. Then this is the total entries we need, right? 20 bits we need for the virtual page number. Then this is total entries in our page table, okay? For this page table entry. Then each entry is 4 bytes, so we have 4 megabytes. So if we have 1,000 processes running at the same time, then we already use around like 4 gigabytes physical memory, which is unacceptable. The reason is that now we didn't load our code, our data. This is only metadata already occupied, like 4 gigabytes memory space, right? So page table are too big, consume too much memory. Then one solution is that we can see that if the page table is huge, so how about we reduce the entry, right? For example, reduce entry means basically we can increase the page size, for example, from four kilobytes page size to 16 kilobytes, then increase 4 times, then our page table size will be reduced 4 times. Now it's 1 megabyte. So the problem here is that when we have a huge page size, although we reduce the page table, however, we waste our memory internal fragmentation, right? Whenever we allocate one page, if we don't use up this page, then we waste, for example, originally, if it's 4 kilobytes each page, then at most we waste 4 kilobytes. Now, if the page is 16 kilobytes, then we waste 16 at most, right? Around 16 kilobytes. So maybe that's a little bit too much, right? So this is the problem for a big page. Certainly at a particular situation, we can use a big page. Also, this is when we set up page size processor usually provides several options for us to select. We do have an option to select big page, but this didn't fundamentally solve the problem because if we increase the page size, we increase the internal fragmentation. Still, we waste our memory space, right? So the particular problem, not only is the page table is big, another issue from this page table is that a lot of page are not used. For example, you look at here. Suppose this is our virtual address space. You can see we have code, we have heap, we have stack here. Okay, so suppose this is our virtual address space, then we have from 0 to 14, okay? This is our virtual address space. Our physical address, suppose we have 26 pages here, okay? Then you can see when we run our process, then actually we only use 4 pages. Okay. You can see. So our page table here, because we only use 4 pages, page 0, page 4, page 13 and 14, right? Then you can see actually, this is our entry here. This entry, this entry, this entry, this entry, okay? Other page, we don't use it. Then if you go to our, this example, because we have a small address space, 16 kilobytes, then maybe it's not that significant. However, if you think about our virtual address space is 4 gigabytes, right? That virtual address space, then we may find a lot of empty entries here, okay? All those entries are empty. However, we have to, if we want to really store this whole table, then we have to allocate memory space. So not only this page table is big, but also a lot of page entries are empty. We don't need to store it. Okay, so this is a go to our solution. Okay, because most entry are empty, okay, then maybe one method is use a hybrid approach. We combine paging and the segment. I think this answers some studio question. See, okay, can we combine them together? Of course. Then basically use this method, then we can for each process, we remember code segment, heap segment, and stack segment as before. User segmentation, right? Then inside each segment, we have a page table, right? So then we can utilize both, right? So generally speaking, we can utilize this one. Then we can remember, we can have a segment table here. Then for each segment, then here we just start our page table. Then use the page table, you find the map. However, this is so complicated, okay? So if you go to the programming, then you will know. For IA32, if you put both segment and paging, then it's impossible to handle. It's very hard to handle, right? So basically, we don't use this one, okay? So I don't want to talk about this one, but generally speaking, you have to go to this for each segment, you have to go to the page table, right? Because for each segment, you have page table. Then after you get the page table, then use the VPN, then get the corresponding address and so on. So so first get the entry, then from this entry, then go to the memory access. So this is too complicated, okay? So this is a, besides the complexity, high complexity, then if we have the heap is sparse, then basically we still have a big page table and so on. The external fragmentation arise again because say if you have if you give more space, then basically we still have the issue, right? So but this in practice we will now use this hybrid approach. In practice, we will use multiple level page table. Okay, this is the most commonly used method for memory management. Okay, general idea is very similar to our indirect pointer. Okay, so basically, now we can have we don't directly store our page entry, we can have some tree we call page directory. So generally speaking is that we can at the first level, we make our page table into multiple level, then Then we have a page directory to tell us where is our corresponding page. Okay, then inside, generally speaking, is that suppose we have page table here. So this is huge, right? Suppose this is our page table. This is huge. Then how about we put those into one page, okay? Inside one memory page to remember the mapping, okay? Oh, this mapping here, this is mapping here, this mapping is here, this mapping here. So in this memory page, we will not directly store the entry. This is used to store the page, corresponding page. Then inside this page, we will store the page table mapping. I'm not sure I make it clear, okay? But you think about that, okay? Originally I have mapping. So every page mapping, I have to have one here, okay? Now I want to see that, I want to put this mapping, okay? All those mapping into one page, okay? Into one memory page, okay? This, all those mapping, right? I put into one memory page. Then I here I have a directory to remember, okay? Oh, this one go to this page. Okay, then inside you find those corresponding mapping. Okay. So we add one level in direction. So let me give you an example, then you will see this clearly, okay? So suppose originally we have this page mapping, you can see here, our BTPR to remember our physical address is, for our page table is 201. Suppose start from here, 201. Then from 201, 202, 203, then we have, this is our page table, right? Okay. Then, now, we want to make it become a tree, okay? And one more level in direction. Then we call it a page directory base address. So we have PDBR to remember. Suppose that our PDTR physical address is 200. That physical page frame 200 is used to represent our kind of page directory. Okay, then this one only tells us for our first part of page mapping, we should go to this page to remember. See, this is still similar to the original one, you can see here, right? Then for our page, the next page directory entry, actually we didn't do any allocation, for example, in this case, okay? Then we don't need anything here, okay? Similar to this one. Then for the TO3, 203, then if we need, then we have, we will say, oh, from this one, you can go to the 203 to find the corresponding entry, okay? Then for this page table, page one, for this page one here, that actually, because we don't have any mapping, then we don't do any allocation here. Then you can see that we, in this way, we suppose originally we need four pages, and now we can remove this page. Then if we have a huge address space, then most page are not allocated related to those page mapping entry. Then basically we only need this root directory. The other part can be allocated on demand. If we need, then later we can allocate this mapping. Okay, so in this way, we can save the space. Okay, then of course, our if we add the interaction, it's become complicated. Now we have to have a page directory. This contain one entry per page of the page table. So page table now is divided into based on the size, right? Divide into page, right? Then the address of this memory physical page frame is used to store this part of a page table is put into our page directory, right? So it consists of a number of page directory entries, right? Then PD has a valid bit and page frame number. Then this one is not this page inside our PTE. This page frame is not directly used to store data. Originally, after we have this, after we get this PFN based on our page table, right? Think about that. So suppose our page table, we have PFN here. Then after we have got PFN, we can directly go to the memory to get data, right? But right now, use PDN, PDE, this entry, our page directory entry. After we get the PFN, then we go to our page table. This is part of our page table. Then from there, then we find the corresponding entry. Then we go to find our memory access. So we add one more level in direction. This is a kind of similar to our indirection pointer, right? Indirection pointer in our inode. Originally, we directly use that data block to store data. Then indirect pointer means we use this data. No, we don't use this data block to store data. We use this data block to store mapping, right? So similar here. Originally, after we go to our page table, we find a PFN, then we directly go to the memory to get data. Now, use PDE, page directory. After we get this PDE, then basically we go to that page frame. This memory page is used to store our mapping. From mapping, then we go to physical memory. So we have one level in direction, okay? So of course, advantage is that we only allocate the page table space on demand, right? We are using, right? So basically, this can help us to save a lot of space. Okay, disadvantage. Basically, this is a trade-off. Time and space trade-off we talk about, right? So we add one more level indirection. So through the page table, we already have two memory access, one more access. Now we add one more access, right? So this shows TLB is important. Generally speaking, if we have this multiple level mapping, then our TLB can hold the page directory entry, that mapping first. Always over there, then you don't need to load this again and again. So basically, although we end this, actually the first kind of the, because hit ratio is very high, so usually the performance penalty is not that much. Okay, then it's not only two levels. Actually, we can even add a multiple level. Okay, so then we can, through this multiple level, then basically we can reduce the memory space. Of course, it introduces more performance penalty, right? So example, if we use page directory, you can see here, this is our page table. Now page table is inside memory. Of course, original also page table is inside memory, but here page table are allocated into a different page, then put into memory, then the reference will be put into the corresponding page frame number will be put into page directory. Then in this case, you can see to run this process, we only need, suppose this is one page, then this is another page, this is another page, we only need four pages. So generally speaking, to run a process, we need a page directory entry here for each process, right? We need one page directory entry. This is one page, okay? Then inside here, then we may need some code, right? Our instruction, we have to allocate instruction in order to run it. We may need some heap, malloc, right? So dynamic allocated data. Then next one is our stack. So then we can run it already. we only need 4 pages. Then basically we can run the, I think from this example, I'm sorry. This is our page table. Right? This is only the page. Then we have to go back to the page table and find our code here. Find our, suppose this is a data code and so on, right? Then our stack. But generally speaking, we only need a very few page. For example, we may need one page for PD entry, then a few page for our page table, okay? Then some physical, this is our code, our real data, right? Our real code and data need to put into the memory. So then we can run our program, okay? Then for the address translation, then if we have a directory entry, then basically we can divide our virtual address into several parts, offside and directory entry, then table entry. Then in each part, we have a base register. For example, for directory entry, we have a PDBR, right? Then from there, goes through our directory entry offside, then find the corresponding page table entry, right? Page table frame, right? This is the PFN, but this we call PPN. Basically, this one is used to store our page table. So then go to this physical page, use this part for our page table entry, right? Corresponding page table entry. And inside we get our PFN. Then go to that PFN, basically, with this offset, then finally we get our physical address. This is a two level, right? So, but we can do more. Okay, we can have more levels. So, let me see the time. So, we are around to use up our time. So I have a few slides here. So then I will go to the example, right? So let me finish. Then tomorrow I will continue to talk about those. Maybe I go back to talk about the thing. So to give a specific example, right? Suppose this is some number we set up over there. Then basically utilize that. Then we can set up into the server part to the allocation. So in the textbook, actually it shows a very detailed example to go through the whole process. So here, I only want to show you how to decide the address, given the address space, given the address, then how to decide which part is offside, which part is virtual page number, and so on, right? For example, in this case, suppose our address space is 16 kilobytes, okay? So which means we have 16 kilo, right? 2^4 times 2^10, which is 16 kilo, right? 2^16. So our virtual address is 2^4 times 2^10, so which is 2^14, right? So our virtual address, you can see, is from 0 to 13, right? Then address space is here. Page size is 16 bytes, which is 2^16, right? 2^6. Okay, so you can see that our offside here inside a page, which is 6 bits from 0 to 5. Okay, so generally speaking, this is the first step to divide. Then if we use this as we don't have a multiple level page table, then we only have one level page table, then we can directly use this VPN to go to our page table, then find the PFN, then finally do memory access, right? To get the memory access. However, if we want to have page directory, okay, we want to add one more level, then Suppose this page direct entry each need one entry per page of the whole page table, okay? So basically, you think about that. So how this is a kind of a little bit kind of confused, but generally speaking is that in total, we have 2^14, right? This is a 14 bit. Then our offset, we have 6 bits, right? So how many entries we have? This is a total address space. Our offset page size 64, right? Okay, then we have 2^8. So this is total entry we need, right? For our page table, right? Now we want to put those entries into pages. Okay, right? Each page we can put 2^6, right? Okay. Wait a second. Okay. Okay, I'm a little bit confused now. Okay, so Okay. So let's go to this is our total entries, page table entries, right? So then each page is 64 bytes. Then suppose each page table entry, say our page table entry, page table entry is 4 bytes, right? Right, for each mapping, we need 4 bytes, suppose, okay? Then we have, we can contain 16 entries, right? For each page, suppose we want to put the mapping. Each mapping is 4 bytes. So we need a, we can contain 16 entries. Okay. Then, yeah. So in total, we have 2^8 entry. Then each page, we can contain 16 entries. Okay. So in total, we have how many pages? 2^4, right? So we have 16 pages, right? So basically, this is the one you can see here. We have this part. This part is for, because we have, we need 16 page entries, right? So our page table directory, we need 16 entries right here to remember, right? So here is our inside this page. Because we have 16 entries, so we have 4 bits to represent the particular entry, right? So this is how we divide the whole our virtual address space. Then after that, you can use this one to find the corresponding page table. Then from that page table, then use this one as an index, find the corresponding entry. Then from that PFN plus this offset, then you can find the physical address. Okay. I know this is a little bit complex, okay? Yeah, I don't want to confuse you guys, but it needs some time. Then also, don't worry, you have a homework to do. So the tutor will give you a very good tutorial to talk about this, don't worry. Then he will talk about multiple level mapping and so on. So don't forget tomorrow's tutorial, which is very important for you to finish assignment four paper-based, okay? It's very simple, okay? Please do attend tomorrow's tutorial, then you know what I'm talking about here. Of course, I will repeat this part a little bit tomorrow, okay? So I guess that's all for today's lecture. Okay, I will go back to the QA section. Okay, so so this is the end of the formal lecture. If you want to continue for the QA section, yeah, you, welcome to stay. Okay. And input your question, right? Input your question into the chat box. Yeah, I know that that part of calculation is not very, very clear. I know. Yeah. Let me see the questions, and then I will go back to like answer your question. Yeah. Maybe I will go back to the slides to talk about that slides. Okay. But to understand this part, please go to tomorrow's tutorial. Okay. Inside tutorial, tutor will give you a lot of example and also directly relate to your homework. Then, yeah. Then you can understand this part. I think I already answered the question. But if you how can you reach is data part runtime? Yeah. So this is a go back to another question. But if we use paging, then how we determine which is the data part, stack part and heap, right? To answer your question, remember, I think we have I'm not sure. Do I have that slides? Yeah, maybe it's not here. So let me show that slides. Okay, I think this is a very important part. So let me go through this part, then you know this clearly. Okay. Yeah, so when we talk about this memory address space, can you guys see my see the screen related to the address space? Hello, guys. Hello, can you see the address space, the slide? Okay, thank you. Okay, so remember when we talk about this one, actually, I think I didn't, I should put this into the slide, then maybe it can help us to understand this better. So I think now we can discuss memory structure, right? So you can see here, for this is an example from Linux. Basically, task structure is inside we have a structure called memory MM, right? Struct. You can see that MM struct basically help us to determine, okay, where is our data, code, BSS, and so on. Then where is our heap? Where is our stack, and so on. Then after that, then we go to our page table, right? So this is our virtual address is defined inside our process. Then over there, we already know our kind of which part is heap, which part is data from our virtual address. Then we go to the page mapping table, then go to the physical memory. Okay, I hope this one can help you understand this to answer your question. Yeah. So in this case, maybe I will use how about I use a paint to answer your question. Yeah. Okay. So can you guys see my screen? I copied some question here. Can you guys see it? Hello? Like now I'm delete some part, for example, file system and so on. Can you guys see it? Okay, thank you. Okay, so I think I answered the first question, right? Yeah, so the first question is that basically my question, to answer a question actually from our process, so we call P process control block, right? So actually we have a structure called memory struct. Of course, this name can be changed. Now from there, we already define where is the, where our virtual address space. So basically where is the where and the bounds of code, data, heap, and so on, right? Stack. Okay, I hope I answered your question. So next question. So the heap and the stack may spare more than one page. Yeah, you are right. So the heap and the stack may cross over multiple pages, right? May occupy, right? Maybe it's occupy. Occupy multiple. Okay. Is this okay? Hello? Can you guys hear me? Uh-huh. I hope everything is normal here, yeah. Because my son now is kind of go to some room class. So we share the bandwidth now. Yeah, so when you malloc or OS will give the whole page, yes, if needed, right, we will allocate page, right? So malloc is complicated, right? So, generally speaking, it's based on page, but in some cases, we may not need to allocate the page. We can reuse some, but to answer your question directly, yes, we do the allocation based on page. So I think I already answered the question, how can we know the bound of each page frame? I think this based on the answer, right? So, page frame, there's no bound, just fixed size, right? So use the PFM, then we can find the address. Okay, so I guess this is the first part. The question, yeah, so yeah, we do have other question. How can we know the bound of, yeah, so yeah, maybe let me, oh my God, okay. Yeah, so now I need to, okay, can I just, yeah, sorry. So I have to copy this again. Okay. So, hardware implementation and so on. Yes. Okay, so the question here, so this question, can a process number of allocated page increase when a process is running? For example, process use up all memory in his heap page. So I don't quite understand the question. So do you mean that when we run this process at the same time, we want to extend our heap? Huh? Is this what you want to, this is your question? But generally speaking, okay, if we run, a process is running, right? Yeah. If we run a process, okay, certainly when we do this extend, we will, if we want to extend our heap, we call the system call, right? When we call the system call, then actually we will trap into the kernel, then we extend our heap. Okay, so in that sense, actually, because the kernel is part, so it depends on how we look at this. Okay, so strictly speaking, when we run a process at the user level, we cannot directly extend his heap. However, when we do the system call, we already trap into the kernel, because the kernel can be recognized as part of the process. Although we trap in the kernel, but this kernel part actually is a service request by this local process. Then at that time, we can extend the heap. Okay. So directly to answer your question, basically user level, we cannot. At user level, we cannot. Okay. But at the kernel, we can. I hope I answered your question. Okay, but yeah, if I didn't, then please, you can tell me directly, or you can input the question. Okay, so how can we know which entry is for which process, right? So basically, this is a kind of like when we talk about TRB, right? In TRB, we need to like inside the TRB, we have this virtual VPN, right? VPN to PFN mapping, right? So to identify, to distinguish from different process, we end into we call address space ID or whatever, right? So basically to help us to differentiate from different mapping, right? Yeah, I think this is a very good question. Yeah, I think at that moment, maybe we didn't talk about this one. So other question I think is related to the kind of IRU, right? Then, but this trade-off with the time. So yeah, so trade-off with the performance, I think this is really true. So to answer this question, so in multiple level page table, we usually have two level instead. No, so this depends on, okay, we can have more. We can have in modern processor, we have multiple level, more than two level, a lot of levels, okay? In terms of how many levels, I could not remember exactly number, but definitely it's over two levels, okay, multiple level. For example, I don't know. Yeah, you guys gave me, I don't know exactly the number, but I do know can be multiple, right? It's greater than two, right? In reality, yeah. Yeah, so yeah, I know this part is a little bit complicated and yeah. So I think more question related to that last slide, right? How, yeah, I think I didn't give you guys a very good explanation for that slide. Yeah, I agree. So the new question is like this, okay? Yeah, so the new question is that, is this fixed or dynamic? Okay, so to answer your question, so this level can be configured. So usually processor provide multiple level, then you can define how many level. For example, you can use a two level, you can use a four level and so on. Yeah, but certainly we have multiple level, right? But before you use it, before you run your operating system, you can define how many level you need. Okay. But after you define it, you cannot change it, right? So dynamically change it, it's impossible, right? So dynamic, so I don't know, it's because dynamic change means you change, if you dynamic change, then you have to change all the mapping table and so on. I don't think that's a very, I'm not sure actually, can we do the dynamic configuration for, I think maybe we don't, it's still okay. You can, for example, when you run a program, you see that I want to switch to the two level, to the three level. I think the processor will not prohibit this kind of switch. But it certainly is very complicated because you have a two-level page table. Now you have to switch to the a different level than a lot of difficult part. You want to make this table consistent. It's in practice is maybe it's difficult, but generally speaking, usually we will have a fixed level. When we use, we will have a fixed level. Okay. But maybe you can dynamically change this one. Okay. I hope I answer your question. Okay, in terms of that slides, right? So you guys want me to go through the slide. So how about I explain this again tomorrow? Because I think I only have a few minutes. I just quickly go through that part. I want to deliver this to all students. Is this okay to you guys? Is this okay? Yeah. So basically, we only have a few students here. So basically, I want to maybe we have more audience tomorrow. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Then thank you guys. Don't forget the tutorial. I will see you tomorrow.